since the beginning of the year, beginning of 2022, I felt God speaking to me about trusting Him completely, trusting Him with everything, trusting Him in every situation, trusting Him with everything that I think about, pray about, trusting with my family, trusting with everything. And the word trust just stood out from the very beginning of this year. Trust God. Trust God. Trust God. Look at the person next to you and say, trust God. Look at that same person and say, I'm trusting God. You know, it could be the same person that you complained to, you know, for quite a while now, you know, and they know all your complaints, they know all your stuff, they know all the things that you're going through and all the circumstances that you face. You know, it's difficult when you look at them now to say, oh, I trust God. You know, it's almost like it's went sour in your mouth, you know. But that is something that I've just had on my heart since the beginning of this year, to trust God in everything. John chapter 14 verse 1 says these words, do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Wow. That's a big statement right there, especially for 2022. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe that word is also a word for to trust in, to rely on, to rely on God, believe, trust in, rely also in me, Jesus' words. Church, this is not a request. Jesus is not making a request saying, do not let your hearts be troubled. If you would like, put your trust in me. He says, no, do not let your hearts be troubled. Put your trust in God. Put it also in me. There's only one way for our hearts not to be troubled, is when our trust is in God. That's the only way. There's no other way. You can make your plans, your strategies, you can have everything together. If your trust is not in God, your heart will be troubled. Do you find that true? If your trust is not in God, your heart will be troubled. Now that sounds very easy to do, especially in a church setting like this, where we are together as the church and we encourage each other and we build each other up, you know. But when you walk out of here this morning and you go into what we would like to call the real world, as if this is not the real world, you know, you walk out of there and you're going into the real world, you know, that's not that easy, John. Well, we're going to explore that a bit this morning. I want to ask Yuri and his three kids to come up here, please, if that's okay. So, actually, I would like CJ. Yes, you, CJ, come up here. Come up here. Come on, let's just give CJ a great clap, man. Hey, this is a great young man. Hey, awesome. Yuri, if that's okay, I would like you to just come stand here. Now, CJ. Big question, my brother. Do you trust that man?
Yes.
Good answer. I'm going to put that to the test. Is that okay?
Yes.
That was a bit of a slider, yes, but that's okay. Okay, so what I would like you to do, right? I would like you to jump off this stage into your dad's arms. You think you can do that?
Yes.
Right, let's see. Hey! Right, come up here again. Come up here again. Come up here again. Right. Is it? Come here. No, no, you stand there. Right. You stand there. Right. Right. CJ. What do you think? Do you trust Izet? And will you jump off this stage into her arms?
No.
Come on, CJ, it's your sister, man. Hey? No?
No.
Zoe, will you come here? Now, this is a bigger sister. Will you jump into her arms?
No.
Still sure? No?
Yep.
Nope. Right. Yuri, would you come back if that's okay? Now, yeah, you said no to them. Will you jump into his arms?
Yes.
Right. Let's see that. Let's give them a hand, will you? Thanks, guys. Thanks, Yuri. Thanks, kids. Church, there is a theme right through the Bible that we cannot do life without God. I want to say this. We need our brothers and our sisters in community, but we have to, in community, put our trust in God. The Bible is full of do not rely on people. Yeah? But put your trust in God. Put your trust in a Father who is able and willing and faithful to catch you when you need it the most. And I want to say this quickly this morning. We try sometimes to do life without God. How do we try that? We keep falling back to our limited understanding of the world and of situations. And then we try to do life in our own understanding. You look at a situation and you think, well, you know, I think this might be the best way of handling this without maybe consulting God or talking to Him about it. And we think, you know, we can rely on our own understanding to get things done. Proverbs 3, verse 5 to 6 says this. And a few weeks ago, Vanine, she spoke about this on our mornings, on a Tuesday in the morning, we give a word of encouragement, and she brought this word, and Proverbs 3, verse 5 to 6 says this, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will make your paths straight. Trust in the Lord. When you have to take a leap and you're not sure of what needs to happen, trust in the Lord. How do we get to the place practically where we put our trust on the Lord, in the Lord, and not lean on our own understanding? A few years ago, I read this book called Ruthless Trust by Brennan Manning. Quite an interesting book. And I felt compelled by the beginning of this year to read it again. And I haven't finished it yet, but I've started reading it again. And it gives some practical ways of how to put your trust in the Lord. He says this, for instance, that trust is an utterly ruthless act. I love that. Trust is an utterly ruthless act. For CJ to be in his father's arms, he had to act. He had to take a leap. He had to say, I trust you that your dad will catch me. If CJ was standing here and I said, do you trust that your dad will catch you? And he said, for sure. I said, take a leap. He said, no way. Do you think his trust is in his dad? Would you think that he trusts his dad? No, he can stand here all day and say, I trust my dad. I trust that he will catch me. I'm sure that he will catch me. I'm positively sure that he will catch me. But if he doesn't take the leap, if he doesn't act, it's just words. Once this Brennan Manning asked one of his best students who became a missionary, he said to him this, he said, Gus, can you define the Christian life in one sentence? Gus answered and said this, he said, sir, I can sum it up in one word, and it is trust. To trust God is to act. Brennan Manning goes further and he tells this story. Now, as you know, I love stories. And he tells this story about John Kavanagh, who came from America and went to India for 3 months. And he worked in what they would call the house. Let me just make sure I get the pronouncing right. The house of the dying. John Kavanagh went for 3 months and he worked in what they call the House of the Dying in Calcutta. And he was seeking the answer on how to best spend the rest of his life. He went there and he said, I want to find the way to best spend the rest of my life. And while he was there, on the first day, he met Mother Teresa. And as you know, she worked there. And he met her and got in a conversation with her. And she said to him, what do you want me to do for you? And he said to her, Mother Teresa, I would like you to pray for me for clarity. I need clarity. I need clarity because I want to know how to best spend the rest of my life. And she looked at him and she said, I will not pray for that. And he said, why not? He said, when I look at your life, it seems like you've got clarity. She looked at him and she said, I've never had clarity for one day in my life. She said, but what I'm going to pray for you, I'm going to pray that you will trust God. You see, by craving clarity, we attempt to eliminate the risk of trusting God. Fear of the unknown path stretching ahead destroys childlike trust in the Father's active goodness and unrestricted love for you and me. You know what's amazing? We often presume that when I put my trust in God, it will dispel the confusion and eliminate the darkness, you know, and it will vanquish the uncertainty and redeem the times. But when you look at Hebrews 11 and you see the crowd of witnesses, they will tell you that this is not true. They will tell you that in circumstances and in difficult times and even in darkness, they trusted God. Brennan Manning says this, and he came to the conclusion that when all else is unclear, the heart of trust says, as Jesus did on the cross, into your hands I commit my spirit. That's trust. Church, I want to say this, that the essence of biblical faith lies in trusting God. You know what I thought at one stage trusting God means? I thought that trusting God means that God exists. If CJ was standing here and his dad was standing there and I asked CJ, I said, CJ, do you believe your dad exists? He would have said, yes, I can see him, he's right there. There's a difference in believing God exists and put your trust in God. There's a difference in believing that God is able to do everything and to put your trust in this God who is able to do everything. There's a difference to believe that God is there and is busy and is working in our lives than it is to put my trust in this God who is there and busy and working and completing what He started in our lives. James chapter 2 verse 19 says this. He says, you believe that there is a God. He says, good. Even the demons believe that and they shudder. So it's one thing to believe that there is a God. It's a total different thing to say, I'm going to trust this God with my whole life. That is the Christian walk. That is the Christian walk, church, to say that I do not just believe He's there, but I'm going to put my trust in Him because I know He cares for me. I know He loves me. I know He's there for me. One John chapter 4, verse 16 says this, and so we know and we rely, we trust, we believe on the love God has for us. You see, and I came to one radical conclusion. And the conclusion is this, that when I talk about trust God and when I talk about put my trust in Him, I can only put my trust in God if I believe that He loves me. If I have a distorted view of how God sees me, if I think that God is someone that sits there, you know, with a stick and just waiting that when I make a mistake that wants to hit me or that I need to crawl to and beg, you know, for His attention or beg for His love or even beg for what He can give me. If I see God in that way, I will never get to the place where I fully trust Him. Because I will always be, you know, thinking, what if I do not do this on the right way? Will God hear my prayer? Will He react in a way, you know, that is pleasing to Him? And can I say this? This was part of my life for a long time growing up. Growing up, I always thought that I had to work for the approval of God's love. As I grew up, I always heard this, if you do this, you're not acceptable. If you do that, you're not acceptable. There was a time where the church preached that if you wore a denim, you were not approved by God. If women wore makeup, they were not approved. As if we made all these outside things, we tried to please God with our behavior, you know, by not doing certain things, not wearing certain things, and we thought that by that way, God will approve of us. Never realizing that John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, God already loved you from before the foundation of the earth, that before you were born, He already loved you. And all He's asking you, He says, trust me. God says, I love you, I care for you, I want the best for you. I want you to trust me. And I hear you ask this question, you know, but what if I trust God and I'm disappointed? And I hear some of you ask this question and said, but I felt I trusted God in the past and He disappointed me. I hear you say, God, but I thought I rearranged my life. So that when I speak to you, when I put my trust in you, that you will do a certain thing for me? Church, can I say this morning? As Brennan Manning said it, to put my trust in God is to come to a place to say, Lord, into your hands I commit my spirit. Father, to you, I give it all. To you, I surrender it all. If it works out the way that I would like it to work out, I will be grateful. If not, I will trust you. God is not a genie that when we rub the bottle, he jumps out and says, yes, master. Sometimes we want to treat him like that. We want to treat him like, you know, we've got the recipe that when we do this, this, that, and the other, then God responds, and he responds with a positive yes, as if God can be manipulated. I want to say to you, and I want to ask you, to get that mindset as far away from you as you can, but to come to a place and to say, Lord, I trust you with everything. If it works out the way that I think, fine. If not, I trust you with everything. We need to become people of surrendering our own will and our own lives into his hands and say, whatever's your will, Lord, I will trust you. In closing this morning, I want to ask you, do you see God in that way? As a loving Father? As one who's only got your best interests at heart? As one who loved you even before you were born? For one who gave himself up for you so that you can be made new. Do you trust him? I want to ask you just to close your eyes for a moment, if that's okay. I remember many years ago, I was a student. I was a first year, and I was studying with Piet and a few other guys. And we were sitting in this coffee shop, and in this coffee shop in Joburg, there was this guy called P.G. Du Plessis. Some of you might remember him from the old stories, Spies en Plessis. And he was sitting there. And as we were joking and sitting around the table, I heard God speak to me, and I heard God say to me, go to him and pray for him. And I said, God, I'm first year student, I'm a first year, you know, there's fourth years and third years here around students that I think they hear you much clearer than what I hear you. I said, well, won't you just talk to them? And I heard God clearly say, you know, not in an audible voice, but in my spirit, I heard him say, no, I've asked you to trust me. And so when I couldn't hold it much longer, I got up from my seat and I walked over to him. He was talking to a lady at the same table. And I remember, you know, I'm not the shortest guy there is, right? And I remember standing up, and everybody was looking at me, and I walked over to him, and I put my hands on the table, and I looked him in the eye, and I said, excuse me, I said, I believe God has laid on my heart to come and pray for you. And the thing that he wants to address in your life is depression. Now you can imagine how that went down. And what felt for me like screaming, maybe he just talked in a very loud voice. He said to me, he said, "No, you cannot pray for me. I am absolutely fine." And I remember how I just felt like, oh God, let the earth just swallow me up. You know, I don't want to be in this place. I don't want to be here, Lord. I don't want to see this. And I remember turning my back to walk away, and the lady called me back. She says, "Excuse me." She said, "Keep doing what you're doing." And I said, "Thank you." But that wasn't why I was there. I didn't go over there to hear, "Keep doing what you're doing." I went there with a mission that I believe God sent me, to pray for a guy who's struggling. A very popular guy. A very seen guy. And I looked at this lady and I said, "Thank you." And as I walked away, he said, "Boot." Now, for our Australian friends, that means just slang for brother, right? He said, "And now suddenly I'm a boot." He said, "Come here." And I thought, oh man, here he goes. Here he comes. Here he comes. And I turned around and I walked back. Then he looked at me and he said, and a tear coming down his face, he looked at me and he said, "This coffee shop is full of people." He says, "You can't pray for me right now. But what I would like you to do is keep me in your prayers. Please pray for me." And I remember walking out of that coffee shop crying, sitting in the back of the car with all these students, and I'm just crying. And I'm saying, "God, it's such a privilege to trust you. Did it work out exactly as I thought? That, you know, in my head, he would fall down on his knees, you know, and let me pray for him, and he would give his life to Jesus, and, you know, and everything, and the depression will just leave him." And that's all, everything that goes on in my head. But God had a way of doing something in me and doing something in him. Church, I want to challenge you this morning. I want to challenge you this morning to put your trust in a loving God. I want to challenge you with every difficulty you face, with everything that's going on around you at the moment, with everything that you experience, I want to challenge you to say, "Jesus, I trust you with everything, and I surrender it all." If you are sitting in this building this morning, while every eye is closed, maybe you're sitting in this building and you've cried out to God, and it just seems like your prayers are just hitting the ceiling and it's not going any further. It feels like God is not hearing you. It feels like you are struggling. It feels like there's no hope. It feels like, "God, I'm crying out here." And this morning you want to come and say again, "Lord, you can have it all. I'm surrendering it all to you." If that is you this morning, I would love to pray for you. But I would like for you to take a ruthless step and an act. I want you to stand up in your seat and say, "Lord, I'm trusting you." If that's you, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I promise you, nobody's going to look around and say, oh, I wonder why he's standing. I wonder why she's standing. I wonder. Nobody. It doesn't matter. This is you and God. This is you and him. This is about you and him putting your trust, your faith, putting your trust back in a loving Father. Maybe this morning I came to tell you, God heard your prayer. The prayer that you thought hit the ceiling, he heard it. The prayer that you thought is unanswered, he heard it. Maybe this morning you just needed to hear, my goodness, God heard. Maybe the enemy has lied to you for so long, making you think that he doesn't love you, making you think that he doesn't care, making you think that you're not good enough, worthy enough. Church, I want to say to you, he heard you. And he sent me with a message this morning. To say he heard you. Put your trust in him. Let's listen to this word.
What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him for all of us, shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's people, his children? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and further, who is risen, and who is even at the right hand of God, who makes intercession and prays for us. Who shall separate us from God's love, from Christ? Shall tribulation, shall distress, shall persecution, shall famine, shall nakedness or peril? Nothing can separate us from the peace of God. And I know in my heart today, God wants to bring love and his forgiveness from his Son to restore us and to give us life and to walk with him. God wants to love you with all him. He loves you so deeply, so much. There's nothing that you've done on this earth that can separate you from the love of our Father. His Son died and has brought you that you can have forgiveness. God wants to restore families, moms, dads, brothers and sisters. Nothing can separate us. Dads, moms, God wants to tell you that you need to continue to love your children unconditionally. Unconditionally. There's no expectation on your children. Just love them absolutely unconditionally. Give your life. Men, you need to give your life for your wives and your children. You need to stand the gap before the Father and love them and pray for them. Do not judge. God says he loves mercy more than judgment. He's here to pardon us and to bring us back to freedom, complete freedom, that only can come from him and his Son.
Jesus. Thanks, Andy. Thank you. That word is so true. I want to speak over your life, that word that Andy just wrote to us, or read to us. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Not your past, not your present, not your future, not your sin, nothing. Nothing can can separate you. He's asking you to trust Him. So, Heavenly Father, I want to thank You this morning that I can pray for each and every person, Lord, that took the bold step to say, Lord, I want to take this ruthless act and I want to stand up. I want to get up out of my seat and I want to say, Lord, I trust You. God, I'll be lying if I said that I don't feel scared. But Lord, I thank You that even in that You hear my cry and You hear what I'm about, Lord, and You say perfect love drives out fear. So Lord, I want to come before You this morning and pray for these people as they trust You this morning, Lord. As they trust You with their whole lives and say, Lord, I just surrender it all. Father, I pray that You will speak to each and every one of them right now through the power of Your Holy Spirit, that they will feel in their hearts and in their minds, in their hearts right now, that they will experience, Lord, You heard this cry of their hearts, this trust You put in them. Everyone who put their trust in the Lord will not be disappointed. In Jesus' name. Can I ask the whole church to stand with me? Don't you just want to say this with your own words and your own prayers? Say, Lord, I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. In your own words, there's a song like that and all of that stuff, but just in your own words, say, Lord, I surrender it all. All my thoughts. Church, as we were praying this morning, and I'm not taking up time, we're going to be done in a second. As we were praying this morning, we really felt God speaking to us about your thoughts and about our minds and how our minds have been clouded and darkened by circumstances and how we need to this morning release that and say, Lord, I trust You and I want to speak life over your mind this morning in Jesus' name. I want to speak life over your mind this morning in Jesus' name so that you can hear what the Word of God is saying to you. I want to speak light. God's light. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, I'm the light of the world. I want to speak that light over your mind this morning, that darkened mind, so that you can hear what it is that God is saying. You can trust Him. So as we stand together, Lord, in this building this morning, as Kingsway family and friends and visitors, we want to proclaim, we surrender it all into the hands of a loving Father who loves us more than anything. In Jesus' name. Amen.